السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So as promised before, we will talk inshallah tonight about a story of leadership in the Quran, which is the story of Talut, the king Talut who was divinely appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over the children of Israel after Musa alayhi salam, and Harun passed away. Some of the ulama, they said there was around maybe 1,000 years between Musa alayhi salam and Talut, but I cannot confirm this number, but this is the opinion of some scholars. So his story was mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah from ayat 246 to around 251. So around maybe five ayat that describe the story of Talut. And they said that he was a king, one of the kings of ancient Israel. In the Hebrew Bible, he was named Saul, S-A-U-L. And he was described as the first king of the United Kingdom of Israel and Judah, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. And what is more important for Muslims, all Muslims at all times, is to know that his story is a beautiful story. It offers great lessons of wisdom and knowledge and hikmah for those, especially for those who are concerned with reform, al-islah al-ijtima'i, social reform, or they are concerned with the state of affairs or the current state of affairs within our ummah these days, or concerned with the psychology of leadership, or the difference between corrupted leader and between, you know, good leaders. So there are many. This story is actually packed with lessons and with wisdom. We'll talk about it inshallah within an hour, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. As I said, this story took place after the time of Musa alayhi salam, after Musa alayhi salam passed away and his brother Harun. What happened is the children of Israel experienced a great deal of humiliation and division. They were divided, they were defeated, they were humiliated. Their children were taken as captives. Some of their women were taken as captives. And their enemies, or the ulama, they said, you know, this happened to them mainly because they disobeyed their prophets and did not follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of their Lord. And their enemies were the local at the time of Talut and Jalut. Their enemies were among the local people of Palestine. And their leader in the Quran, in this story, is named Jalut. In the Bible, he's Goliath. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ikhwan, this is something before we start talking about the story, this is very important. And I mentioned this point today in my khutbah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about their stories because they were the Muslims at that time. They were the Muslims at that time. They were supposed to follow, and many of them actually followed their prophets and messengers. So basically anyone who followed the true prophet and submitted his will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a Muslim. So all those people who followed Adam alayhi salam, believed in Adam alayhi salam, Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, Isa alayhi salam, Dawood, Sulaiman, all the prophets, all of them who followed them and they submitted their will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they believed in the Aqidah of Tawheed, they are all Muslims. So we are not the only Muslims on earth. Talking about the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the community of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And what is the difference here? You could call them ancient Muslims. I mean, they are the children of Israel. Who is Israel? He is Yaqub alayhi salam. He had 12 children. And through these 12 children, we got 12 tribes. And so in their, you know, descendants, among their descendants, we found prophets and kings. So here Talut is one of their descendants, and Musa alayhi salam and Harun were actually the descendants of Ya'qub alayhi salam through his son Levi. In Arabic, his name is Lawi. So you could call them ancient Muslims, but what is the difference here? This is very important, ya ikhwan. Does it matter, yani, if we call them Jews or children of Israel or ancient Muslims? What's the difference? And who cares about the difference in names? Now, for those who are serious about the lessons of the Quran, the guidance of the Quran, this difference of names is not important. Because for them, for those people who are serious, who take the guidance of the Quran seriously, and they try to understand the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His book, any lesson, any story that is mentioned in the Quran is a source of guidance. And they take it seriously. Whether it happened within the Israeli community or it happened to another community, whether it is, to this community, the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam at the time of Sahaba, it doesn't make a difference for them. But the problem, many Muslims nowadays, when they hear these stories, especially some speakers, they will tell them, مثلا, oh, these are the akhlaq of Banu Israel, these are the manners of the Yahud. So automatically what will happen? They will feel like, okay, these are the Yahud, and these are their stories, we have nothing to do with them. So we are not concerned with this guidance. Or we are not concerned with these problems. We are the Ummah, we belong to the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is a dangerous matter of confusion. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected these stories. There are many stories that took place on earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected these stories in the Quran for a reason. For you and me to and all the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam till the day of judgment to study them, to understand them, and learn from their wisdom and follow the guidance that is there. So if we call them ancient Muslims, what does it mean? I mean, this is an old Muslim community. If this is what happened to them, it could happen to any Muslim community at all times. And actually, we are experiencing this. If you look at the state of our affairs these days, you will find that there is a big similarity between our conditions these days and their conditions at that time. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So now, the story in the Quran is short and sweet and to the point. Because if you go to the Old Testament, it's a different story. You study some books written about Talut, for example, about Saul and his kingdom and his reign. At that time, he's described in a different way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about this story in 5 ayat. As I said, short and sweet and very beneficial. So you don't need to go to other sources to look for guidance, you know, regarding this story. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started this story by saying, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الْمَلَأِ مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مُوسَى. And it was most likely was addressing our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Have you not thought about the leaders of Banu Israel after the time of Musa alayhi salam? This is the first part of this ayah 246. Have you not thought about the leaders of Banu Israel? So here we are talking about al-mala'. And al-mala', they are called al-mala' in Arabic, لأنهم يملؤون عيون الناس بأموالهم وبمكانتهم وبجاههم. So they are called mala, and the word mala in Arabic is fullness. So they said the ulama, they are called mala in Arabic because they fill the eyes of people with their wealth, with their power, with their status. They are the elites. They are the leaders. But they are divided leaders because they used to rule different tribes and different, and they were not united at that time when they came to their prophet. So, إِذْ قَالُوا لِنَبِيٍّ لَهُمْ إِبْعَثْ لَنَا مَلِكًا نُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَلَمْ تَرَى. Rasulullah ﷺ was not there. So Rasulullah ﷺ could not see what happened. But they said, the ulama, they said, this usloob, this methodology in the Quran is to grab the attention of the listener, or to grab the attention of Muhammad ﷺ. Have you not thought about the leaders of Banu Israel when they came to their one of their prophets, and Allah did not mention his name? He mentioned Talut, who is a king. He's not like a prophet. The status of a prophet is definitely higher than the status of a king. And the leader of their enemies, who was a kafir at that time, Jalut, Goliath, was mentioned. His name was mentioned in the story. But the name of this prophet was not mentioned. In the Hebrew Bible, it is Samuel, or in Arabic, Shamuel. And some ulama of tafsir have mentioned his name in their books of tafsir. They took this knowledge from some Jewish scholars who accepted Islam, like Abdullah ibn Munabbih and some other scholars who were, they were Jewish scholars, and they got some knowledge about the Old Testament and their own holy books, and then they accepted Islam at the time of the Sahaba, and they became Muslim scholars. So these are called al-Israiliyat, Israeli narrations. And Rasulullah ﷺ said, do not accept them and do not reject them. Because they could be truth. I mean, if you reject them, you could be rejecting something that is true. If you accept them without knowledge, then you could be accepting something that is wrong. Unless they confirm something, or they are confirmed by an ayah from the Quran or a hadith from the sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ. Here, this matter is not really important because we are talking about his name. And the ulama of tafsir are divided in two groups. Some of them have chosen to mention his name in their books of tafsir. And he said he's a prophet Samuel. Some other ulama of tafsir said, had it been beneficial for us to know his name, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have mentioned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have mentioned his name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose not to mention his name. So it means it's not important. His name is not important. Wallahu ta'ala alam. And that's why we keep saying the prophet or their prophet in this story. So إِذْ قَالُوا لِنَبِيٍّ لَهُمْ إِبْعَثْ لَنَا مَلِكًا نُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. When they said to the prophet of theirs, appoint for us a king and we will fight in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they were humiliated, defeated. They were in a very weak situation and divided into groups and tribes. So they came to their prophet at that time, and they wanted him to appoint a prophet, a king over them. So they are asking for unity here, to be united under the leadership of one king. But their prophet was not sure about the truthfulness of their claim, of their statement, and the sincerity of their intentions. Their prophet was not sure. He was not confident. And we'll talk about the psychology here of corrupted leaders. This is very important. So he said, قَالَ هَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ إِن كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ أَلَّا تُقَاتِلُوا. He said, would you perhaps refrain from fighting if fighting was prescribed for you? That was his statement. So what was their reaction to his statement? Because he was not sure, he was not confident, as I said, about, the truthfulness of their statement. Are they serious? They want unity. These people want unity, and they want to be united under the leadership of one man, and they want to fight for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then that was their reaction, was very, very strong. They said, "Qalu wa ma lana alla nuqatila fi sabilillah, wa qad ukhrijna min diyarina wa abna'ina." The reaction very strong. They said, "And why should we not fight for the sake of Allah? And when we have been driven out from our homes and our children." So here the tone of their reply indicates that they were amazed at his statement, or they actually pretended to be amazed. And it's like saying, Mathan, what are you talking about? Don't you see that we have been driven out from our homes and our children? Of course we will fight for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course we will be united under the leadership of one man and one king. Just appoint this king over us, and then we will follow him, and we will obey his orders and his commands. So it's like there is no question about it. You shouldn't ask this question. Then what happened is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us at the end of this ayah 246, فَلَمَّا كُتِبَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقِتَالُ تَوَلَّوْا إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْهُمْ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِالظَّالِمِينَ. At the end of the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that many of them have failed the test. Because these are the talkers. Talk is cheap, ya ikhwan. Lip service. Talk is very cheap. But here the reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after they made this request, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing them now. So fighting was made an obligation upon them. It's an obligation now. We're going to see what you do. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that most of them have failed this test or this filter, the filter of truthfulness and sincerity. So he said when fighting was prescribed for them at the end of the ayah, they turned away, except a few of them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is knowing of the wrongdoers. Allah knows their intention, and he knows their politics. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to prove to them and expose their intentions. This is what you want? Here you go. Fighting was prescribed against your enemies. But most of them turned away, as I said. So they came to their prophet. Let's analyze what happened here before we move to the next ayah. And these, as I said, these are leaders of humiliation, leaders of bad times, leaders of division, leaders of corruption, right? So we need to know, look at their requests or their demands, their three demands. They came to their prophet with three demands. The first one is to appoint over them a king. And the second, this king should lead them to fight against their enemies. And the fight should be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Three demands. At the surface, when you look at them, they are good because these people were defeated, their homes were destroyed, their children were taken as captives and their women. I mean, they have every reason to fight their enemies and defend their honor and dignity and restore their conditions. So these are good demands when you look at them at the surface. But it is, some ulama, they said it is strange for these requests or these demands to come from these people. Why? They said the first demand, they ask for unity, as I said, to be united under the leadership of one king or one man. This is something that should raise some questions here and some doubts. Why? Because they said corrupted leaders do not like unity. This is something that Muslims have to know. Corrupted leaders do not like unity. Why? It will cost them their positions of leadership. Because they are mainly concerned with their own personal interest. If they are united under the leadership of one king and one leader, they will lose this privilege. They will lose these positions of authority. And only someone who has faith and humbleness, and he's really concerned about the well-being of the community or the ummah, this person will be willing to give up his position of authority for the sake of unity, for the sake of the well-being of the group, maslahat al-jami', the public interest. But corrupted leaders are not concerned with the public interest. They are not concerned with the well-being of the jama'ah. That's why they hold fast to their positions. So it was weird, it was strange for this demand to come from these people. And they said they don't like to fight because it would cost them their lives. And they are not genuine about their claim for doing things fi sabilillah. And the next ayah will be a proof for this analysis. The next ayah and the ayah after will be a proof that this is what happened. These were their intentions. What happened in the next ayah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, وَقَالَ لَهُمْ نَبِيُّهُمْ in ayah 247. وقال لهم نبيهم إن الله قد بعث لكم طالوت ملكا. So now we have the first filter. Some of them, they said, when they knew that fighting was made as an obligation upon them, turned away. So there is a group of people who still, you know, firm in their position and they want to continue with their prophet. Now this prophet is coming to them and telling them, طيب وقال لهم نبيهم إن الله قد بعث لكم طالوت ملكا قالوا أنى يكون له الملك علينا ونحن أحق بالملك منه ولم يؤت سعة من المال. So now here is the argument. So they said, their prophet said to them, indeed Allah has sent to you Saul or Talut as a king. They said, how can he be a king over us? Pay attention to this. Their prophet is telling them, Allah has sent this king over you. It was not my decision. Allah has chosen him to be a king over you. So this is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They said, how can he be a king over us when we are better fitted for kingdom? We are worthy, more worthy of this position than him. And he was not, and he's not wealthy. He doesn't have money. There's a problem here. They are arguing with their prophet and rejecting the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this command is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that means they are rejecting the unity that they came and asked for it in the beginning. Now unity is not serving them, because they don't like this king. He's not one of them, or he's not one of their qabila. I'll talk about their qabail and differences between their tribes now. So he's not one of them, and he doesn't deserve to be a king, appointed as a king. But the Prophet is telling them, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who appointed him as as a king over you. So now his kingdom or his leadership does not serve their agenda. It does not protect their interest. It doesn't protect their leadership. They refused. As I said, the Ya'qub alayhi salam had 12 children, and from these 12 children we got 12 tribes. So the ulama, they said, the kingdom was in the tribe of Yehuda, in English Judah. And the prophets used to come from the his child, who was named Levi or Lawi in Arabic. And Talut, who was appointed as a king, was neither from the tribe of Judah nor from the tribe of Levi. He was from the tribe of Benjamin. You know the story of Yusuf alayhi salam? Yusuf alayhi salam had a brother. Benjamin is the full brother of Yusuf alayhi salam. So Talut was from the descendants of Benjamin in English. So basically they are saying here, he is not from our tribe. He doesn't deserve this position. And the second argument is, he is not wealthy. He does not have money. So these are their agreement. Their arguments, and this is a proof that they were not sincere in the beginning when they asked for unity or asked for a king to be appointed over them. And these are jahili criteria, ikhwan. The criteria of jahiliya have no place in our Islam, in our Deen. That's why at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I'll tell you about the story. And this is a reality that we find nowadays in experience in our communities. At the time of when Rasulullah ﷺ passed away, there was someone who claimed that he's a prophet, who was Musaylama al-Kadhab, Musaylama the liar. And he was from Qabilat al-Yamama, who was from the area of Yamama. So there was a leader in his people who came to Musaylama. And he wanted to test his claim of prophethood. So Musaylama, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. People knew, the Sahaba knew, the Muslims at that time knew that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger. There should be no prophet after him. But there are people who became excited and they wanted to taste this position of a new position in the Arabian Peninsula, the position of prophethood, claiming to be a prophet. There are other people who claim to be prophets, after the death of Rasulullah ﷺ beside Musaylama. But Musaylama was very famous at that time. So this leader, this Arab leader, came to Musaylama and he asked him some questions about the nature of wahi, of revelation that he receives. A day, during day or time, he told him during night time. And then at the end he said, he made a statement. He said, إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ كَذَّابٌ. He said, وَلَكِنَّ كَذَّابَ رَبِيعَةٍ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْنَا مِنْ صَادِقِ مُضَرٍ. And this is an Arabic, saying here at that time. Jahili Arabic saying. He said, I bear witness that you are a liar. You are lying. You are not a prophet. But he said, كَذِبُ أَوْ كَذَّابُ رَبِيعَةٍ. Liar from Rabi'ah, from our tribe, is more beloved to us than the truthful person from Mudar, from another tribe. So we are willing to give support to this liar against the truthful leader from another tribe. We know that he's truthful and we know that our leader is lying, but this is al-asabiyya, partisanship. This is love for hizbiyya and asabiyya. We are willing to give support to our leader because he is one of us. So here, this is what these people did now. And of course, this is one of our problems nowadays. This is one of our problems. They said they rejected his leadership because he's not from our tribe and he's not wealthy, he doesn't have money. What was the response of their prophet? He said, قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَزَادَهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ وَاللَّهُ يُؤْتِي مُلْكَهُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. So their prophet just confirmed to them what he said before. He told them before that he was appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not my ijtihad. It was not my opinion. He was appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm just conveying the message to you. So here in his response, he just confirmed what he said before. قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ. He said, indeed, Allah has chosen him over you and has increased him. We are concerned actually with these qualities now. Because we cannot hope to have this first quality. For someone to be appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no way we can get this. These days, we don't have prophets among us, because only prophets get this wahi and revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is not relevant. What is relevant to our conditions and the current state of our affairs is the two conditions that he will mention. And there is no problem here if we have a point that is not relevant and we cannot have it these days. It's not a problem because we know why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed this king over them. We have the qualities, we have the qualifications. So no one can come and say, this story is not beneficial. We shouldn't look at it because there is a divine appointment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that we cannot have it these days. Right? So this point is there, yes, but we can still benefit from this story and look at the qualities or the qualifications of leaders when we select them and vote for them. So here he mentioned why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him as a leader among them. He said he increased him abundantly in what? In knowledge. وَزَادَهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ. So a leader has to be knowledgeable. If he's a religious leader, he has to know the deen. If he's ignorant, then he will lead his people into misguidance, right? He has to be knowledgeable, he has to have authentic knowledge. And here he said, بَسْطَةً فِي الْجِسْمِ. بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ. And stature or physical strength. Why? Because they want him to be the leader of the army. He will be the king, but at the same time, he will be leading the army. So he has to be someone who has physical power, and he knows how to fight. Especially at that time, you know, they didn't have these sophisticated weapons and those studies, and you know, leaders did not go to at that time to university and study about strategies of war and weapons and all these things. I mean, the way they used to fight, it was very simple. They used to rely mainly on physical power, physical strength, mainly rely on those who know how to fight and use the swords and those simple weapons that they use, they were used at that time. So, and then at the end, he told them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives his sovereignty to whom he wills. This is the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يفعل ما يشاء. He does what he wills. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills something, then we have to, what should be our response, what should be our attitude? سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We listened and we obeyed. That should be the attitude of a believer, someone who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger. This is the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We just have to follow. If you want to succeed and achieve your goals, because without following the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will not achieve anything. We are not going to change our conditions. We will never change our ummah nowadays. We will never be able to change. I'm not trying to make you lose hope in the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. Actually, part of our iman, of good faith, of being a good mu'min, is to have hope in the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. And we know that we are facing difficult, it's a difficult time. Our ummah is facing difficult time. But we know the way out. We know how to solve our problems. And we know what is the best way to change our conditions is to go back to the condition, to the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the guidance of the Quran. And there is guidance for everything we do in our life. If you think about family life, if you think business, if you think about politics, for everything, there is some guidance there that is there available for us, easy to access, easy to understand. As I said, you know, alhamdulillah, translations are available, books of tafsir are available. We don't have, it's not difficult to reach this guidance, to get access to this knowledge. We just have to have the desire. Now these people, their problem is, they didn't have the desire to follow the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their prophet is telling them, this man was appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They rejected his statement, and they came up with their own arguments. So here, as I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet confirmed what he said before, that this man was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he has more knowledge than you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with wisdom, with hikmah, with ilm, and this is a qualification. It should be, you know, when we select our leaders. Yani, it is a shame that we go to some masajid and we find the person who is in charge of the masjid has nothing to do with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You look at his lifestyle, he has nothing to do with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't come to the five daily prayers. I'm not judging people here, talking about our Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When a problem happens in the community, he would stand up on the mimbar and he would say, مَا بَالُ أَقْوَامٍ يَقُولُونَ كَذَا وَكَذَا مَا بَالُ أَقْوَامٍ يَفْعَلُونَ كَذَا. Why some people are some people doing this and that? Why are some people saying this and that? And he would deal with the problem right away. If we become coward and we don't talk about our problems, we are not going to solve them. So it is a shame that you go to some places, Muslim places, and you find the one person in charge has nothing to do with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in charge of a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, people are coming, supposed to come and teach and learn and pray. It is one of the problems that we are facing in our communities nowadays. Or you look at the Muslim world, And you look at the quality of leaders that we have. نحن نعيش في عصر يؤتمن فيه الخائن ويخون فيه الأمين. So the honest person is treated as a dishonest. So the good people are rejected in our communities. The people who memorize the Quran, who have knowledge, we know their intention. I mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows their intentions, but we look at their plans and their work and their amal, and they're in different communities in the Muslim world. Good people who were trying to establish the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, they are thrown in jail, some of them are killed, some of them. And this is happening to us because of these problems. We are not, as an ummah, we don't have the desire to follow the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you find the majority of people, or at least some of the people who live in these countries, are just keeping quiet about everything, or they are following the bad leaders, the corrupted leaders that are ruling them nowadays. Anyway, so in the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He sent them a sign as a proof for the kingdom and leadership of Talut. Of course, this is not relevant to our times, but it's good to know about it. And the ulama are not sure if they ask for a sign or their prophet ask for a sign so to strengthen their iman and their faith, to strengthen the faith of his followers. The ulama is not, they are not sure about it. Whether they ask for it, they said, we need a mu'jiza, a miracle, something we can see it with our eyes. Or the Prophet himself made a dua asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send a sign for these people so they can believe. They will be satisfied with the wahi, with the appointment, with the appointment of Talut. قال لهم نبيهم إن آية ملكه أن يأتيكم التابوت فيه سكينة من ربكم وبقية مما ترك آل موسى وآل هارون تحمله الملائكة. So their prophet said to them, verily the sign of his kingdom, the sign of his appointment or his leadership, is that there shall come to you a tabut. What is a tabut? A tabut is a wooden box. And this wooden box has in it some remnants, some athar of Musa alayhi salam and Harun. These people, the Israeli at that time, the children of Israel, whenever they used to fight with their enemies, they used to carry this tabut with them because they used to believe this tabut, this wooden box, is a blessed box. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to give them victory over against their enemies because of the barakah of this tabut. That was their belief. So when Jalut and his army took this box from them, actually they are the ones, Jalut and his army, long time ago, took this tabut from them in one of their battles. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to show them a miracle, a sign. He brought this tabut to them again. And who brought them the tabut? The malaika, the angels. Can you ask for something more powerful than this sign? The malaika themselves coming to them, bringing this tabut to them. Here you go, your tabut. So now when they saw this mu'jiza, you know, they said they believed. And they followed Talut. Now we are satisfied. Talut is our leader, and we will follow him, and we'll be members of his army. Now, but Talut, was not satisfied with the firmness or the determination or the faith of the whole group. He was not satisfied. Because Talut does not want to proceed, set out with his army with people who are shaken, people who have no firm Aqidah. Because he knew that if he meets his enemy with this kind of people, he will be defeated. So he wanted to test them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about this test in the next ayah, which is maybe 250. And he wanted to test their discipline and self-control. You know, one of our problems nowadays, discipline. We don't have discipline. We don't like to listen to our leaders. You know, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu were successful because they were highly disciplined. And nowadays we are, many of our youth, especially who are joining extremist or extreme groups, because they believe that all their scholars are corrupted scholars, and this is not true. Or all the scholars are not saying the truth. They are hiding something. All the scholars are not willing to talk about jihad. You know what I mean? So now, what is the alternative? Is ISIS and Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi and those things. We don't have discipline. Many scholars understand the game. It's a very difficult game now. And Muslims have to learn how to play it. But the young people, they don't understand this game. And they don't have the ability, actually. But the problem is, they're not satisfied with their knowledge, and they say, Alhamdulillah, I have a limited knowledge now. I should learn before I make a dangerous decision. A very dangerous decision, joining ISIS or joining Al-Qaeda or those things. You know, Syrian people are suffering now because of these problems. One of their problems is ISIS. One of their enemies now in Syria is ISIS. And Russians there who are bombing the Syrians now, they're not attacking ISIS. But our young people do not understand this. ISIS there in Syria is a card, is not a player. Bashar is using this card. The Russians are using this card. The Americans are using this card. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and yu'een as-Suriyin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them victory. It's a very difficult situation there. But the problem is we don't read and we don't try to understand and we rush into making conclusions and making decisions. But anyway, that's a different topic. I don't know why. I mean, that's a different topic. But it has to do with discipline. We don't have discipline. And we don't have self-control. You know, Abu Basir, I will tell you here the story of Abu Basir. There was an agreement between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Meccans. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed to some difficult conditions, or terms, I would say, in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. You know what was one of the terms? They told him, the Meccan leaders, if someone from Mecca accept Islam and it comes to you, you have to return him to Mecca. And if someone becomes an apostate and rejects Islam and goes back to Mecca, they don't have the obligation to return him to Al-Madina. Do you think this is fair? Huh? But Rasulullah ﷺ signed this agreement. Abu Bakr, he knew. This is the Prophet of Allah. Sami'na wa ata'na. Abu Bakr. That was, he was called the Siddiq. He had trust in the leadership. Umar radiallahu anhu, he knew the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he loved him and he trusted him. But because he was different than Abu Bakr. Umar did not accept these terms. And he said, this is not fair, this is oppression. But he said, I regretted my reaction for the rest of my life on that day. When he discovered that what Rasulullah did with the people of Mecca actually was the right thing to do, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make a way out for them because of their taqwa and their patience. What happened? Abu Basir accepted Islam. And he came to Al-Madinah. Rasulullah said, I have to return you to Mecca. There's an agreement. I cannot betray my, break my promise and break my covenant with the people. Even they are kuffar, but this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Discipline is not about, we don't follow our desires when it comes to these things. You give a covenant, a promise, you fulfill your promise. This is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether you're dealing with a Hindu, with a Christian, with a Buddhist, you made a covenant and you signed it. You have to fulfill your promise. This is, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, awfu bil'uqud. He said, I have no choice. I will return you to Mecca. So two people from the Meccans came with their swords to take Abu Basir back. And then Abu Basir went back with them. He didn't say that you are a traitor, you are a disbeliever, you are a kafir, how come you return me to the Meccans? He accepted what? He accepted what?
Islam.
The decision of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was Muslim before. He accepted the decision of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a way out for him. He was able to kill these two people, these guards, and then went back to Al-Madinah. He went back to Al-Madinah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam cannot accept him. He said, "Wayha wa ila ummih musa'ir harbin law kana ma'ahu rijal." His woe to him, he's a warrior, he's a great warrior, if he had man with him, if he had power. So Abu Basir, he understood that Rasulullah ﷺ will not accept him, will not allow him to stay in Medina. He made a decision to leave the city of Medina, and he stayed in a different area. Not in Mecca, not in Medina, in a different area. And then those Muslims who accepted Islam started what? Joining Abu Basir. So they formed a group, and they were threatening the routes of trade of the Meccans, the trading routes of the Meccans. So the Meccans said, let's cancel this term now. Let's cancel this term now. And then whoever accepted Islam was allowed to join the Muslim community in Medina. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a way out of the Muslim community and to all Muslims because of their taqwa. Because of their taqwa, their discipline. They listen to their leader. Now, one of their problems, we don't like to listen to our leaders, especially Sunni Muslims. I'm not saying you worship your leaders like other people do. But we need some balance here, ya akhwan. We need some, if someone is appointed and we know that he deserves he's well deserving of the position of leadership. We know that he's not a corrupted leader. Then we need to listen and respect, and even if we don't like, that's why we have shura, mashura. When we do mashura, if we do mashura now, and like everyone have an opinion and say, let's move mashura and go with the opinion of majority, and I have a different opinion, and everyone is against my opinion, I have to follow the opinion of the majority. This is discipline. And we don't have it nowadays. You get seven people, they are elected in a board, they don't agree with each other, and they start fighting with each other for their term, during the whole term, 2 years or 3 years. And where are the masalih, the interests of the ummah, the interests of the community? They're gone. Our youth are in the streets now. There's no one to take care of them because our leaders are fighting with each other. No self-discipline. There's arrogance. Arrogance actually is motivating, controlling our affairs. Anyway, so here he decided to look at their discipline, their self-control. And he told them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be testing you with a river. And some ulama, they said it is the river of Jordan. They called it Nahr al-Urdun. It's found in Jordan nowadays. Whoever drinks from it is not from me. Whoever drinks from this river will not be a member of this army. You are out. And then he said, whoever does not taste it is indeed of me. He will belong to this army. He will stay with me. Except the one who takes from it in the hollow of his hands. They were allowed to drink from it, small quantity of water from this river. But if you go beyond that, then you are someone who was not able to control his desires. You have no self-discipline. You have no discipline, you have no self-control, you are out of the army. That was the test of Talut alayhi, he was not a prophet, rahmatullahi alayhi. And that was, as I said, the filter of, the self-control. Now, at the end comes another filter, the filter of al-yaqeen. So, these people left, there was a small group left. And they crossed the river with Talut. After they crossed the river, now they saw the army of Jalut. It was a big army. They were called the Amalekites. Amalika. They were tall people. And Jalut, Goliath himself, was very tall. And these people look at them and said, لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا الْيَوْمَ بِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ. He said, we have no power, there is no power for us today against Goliath and his soldiers. That was the statement of some of them. This is what? The filter or test of yaqeen. Yaqeen about what? Yaqeen about the promise of Allah. That victory comes from Allah. It doesn't come from through your weapons or your ability or your skills or your numbers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not care about numbers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cares about quality. Quality over quantity. So here, yaqeen. It's a difficult moment when a small army is in front facing a big army here. So if they don't have, both of them don't have iman and faith, definitely the bigger army will defeat the small army. But there is another criteria. The people of iman have another criteria. They believe that victory only comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but those who were certain they would meet Allah. عندهم يقين بلقاء الله عز وجل. يقين about al-akhirah. They have no doubt about al-akhirah. That the one day they will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are here to sacrifice their souls and their blood for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they are doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they said, كم من فئة قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله والله مع الصابرين. They said, how many, a small group, has overcome a large group by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is with the patient. And as I said, you know, about the relevance is very important of this ayah, this story. I actually mentioned about it that there are some points that are not relevant to our times, but there are many things that are relevant to our times. Now here, these qualities of yaqeen and sabr, they are needed all times. Yaqeen, certainty, and patience. Actually, one of the requirements of those who will be the winners on the Day of Judgment is patience. Patience. They have to be among the patient. Otherwise, they will not be included within the successful people, within the successful group on the Day of Judgment. What is the proof? Surat Al-Asr. Yes, Surat Al-Asr. وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. So everyone is a loser except those who believe. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, perform good deeds. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ, advise each other to follow the truth, and advise each other to be patient. So patience is a requirement. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Sajda said, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. Qualification of leadership. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. We made them leaders who guide with our permission and guide with our guidance. He, again, talking about the children of Israel, but it is a lesson for this ummah. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً. We made them leaders to guide with our permission and with our guidance. لَمَّا صَبَرُوا, when they were patient. وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يوقنون, and they had yaqeen, certainty about our ayat. And here he, of course, ayat could include the verses of the Quran, it could include this ayat, the signs of creation, and mainly it includes here the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if you do this and this and this, Allah will give you this. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. But then people nowadays doing business and dealing with interest. We tell them, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Leave this job, leave this business. If you have taqwa, Allah will make a way out for you. And will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for you from ways you did not expect. And this is the promise of Allah. This is not the promise of the imam or so and so. This is the promise of Allah in Surah At-Talaq, chapter 65. So and I, mashallah, there are wallahi many brothers who said, I left this job and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me with a better job. Wallahi, I met a couple of brothers who told me, I left my job because they didn't allow me to go to Jum'ah. And alhamdulillah, wallahi, when I left it. He said, after a couple of weeks, I got an offer, a better job, and I am now allowed to go to Jum'ah. And it's a better salary. You leave something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A Muslim one time, he told me in British Columbia, he said, you know, we're a group of Muslims working in a company, and the owner was not Muslim, did not allow us to go to Jum'ah. Did not. And he said, I wanted to, I wrote actually a letter to the union, and I contacted some authorities, some agencies, and he said, the Muslims, many Muslims working with me, were saying, what are you doing? You're gonna lose your job. And the brother was telling them, have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is your Jum'ah. And you are al-haq, following the truth. You know, this is your right here. You have the right to go for Jum'ah. And I mean, they have the right to accommodate your religious needs. And he said, wallahi, many Muslims, they are the ones who were trying to stop him from doing that. He said, wallahi, I was successful in my, alhamdulillah, in my task. And he was allowed to take Jum'ah, the day of Jum'ah, off and work instead of it on Saturday. It doesn't happen to everyone, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to try all the time. When facing a difficult situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to look for the path. Where is the path of taqwa? Where is the path of taqwa? There could be different options, different solutions. Where is the path of taqwa? Here it is. You follow the path of taqwa, Allah will make a way out for you, provide for you from ways you did not expect. This is His promise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyib, we know at the end what happened. How many people were left at the end? Some scholars, they said, in the beginning there were 80,000. I'm not sure about this number, to tell you the truth. I have to be honest. But I am confident about the second number because it is in Sahih al-Bukhari. Authentic hadith. The second number, how many were left at the end? The same number, na'am? 313. The same number of the Sahaba of Badr. The Sahaba of Badr were between 300, there's some ulama, they said between 313 till maximum 317. So they said, there is a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, the number of the Muslims who stayed with Talut after he crossed the river were the same, like the same number of Sahabas, the Sahabas who fought with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Ghazwa of Badr. 313, 314, same thing. Small number, and they were victorious. You know, Goliath was a giant. You know who killed him? It's not Talut. Dawood alayhi salam. He was not a prophet at that time. He was a young man. And he killed him with what? With a slingshot. With a slingshot, with a rock. He hit him with a rock in the face, and Jalut was gone. So when the army of Jalut saw their leaders actually falling on the ground, they were what? Shaken. That's it. Hazima nafsiya. Psychological defeat now. The leader is gone. This giant now is killed. So Dawood alayhi salam killed Jalut or Goliath, and he became a prophet after the death of Talut. In the Old Testament, they said one of the sons of Talut became a king, and then after that Dawood became a king. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention the son of Talut. He mentioned directly after he told us about this battle, he mentioned the kingdom of Dawood alayhi salam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed him as a king after that, and he blessed him with knowledge and with wisdom and with kingdom. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا لكل خير. اللهم اغفر لنا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم.